One, two, one, two. One, two, three, four. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Can I invite you, if you are able, please to stand? Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
Risen today. Let us make our approach to God. Let us pray. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy gave us a new birth unto a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Praise be to Jesus Christ, the Son, the Lamb of God, who has taken on himself all the sin of the world and is risen this day to everlasting life and glory. Praise be to God, the Holy Spirit, who raises us to new life with Christ. Praise and thanks and blessing be to God, the King and Saviour of creation, on this day of victory and light. Almighty Father, it is through your mercy we can come with joy to greet the risen Christ, and not through any merit in ourselves. We know and acknowledge that we are guilty of the very sins that drove him to the cross. Disloyalty and cowardice, jealousy and twisted thinking, wrong values and short-sighted vision. Father, in the love that radiates from Jesus' empty cross, forgive us. Then raise us up to the level of a new and finer life in Christ. Let the joy of Christ alive reach deep down into each and every one of us. The recollection of Christ crucified dictate our values and our thinking and our speaking, till all our actions and attitudes are purified and Christ is reflected in each and every one of us. Lord Jesus, as you made yourself known to the people who most loved you and missed you, make yourself known on this resurrection day to any who have felt cut off from you, any who are burdened by a sense of guilt, any who feel that joy has gone out of their life forever. And as you dealt patiently with the problems of Thomas, deal patiently too with all people who are handicapped by closed minds, all those who are held back from faith by intellectual barriers of doubt. And as you spoke gently to Mary in the garden in the midst of our grief, so speak also to those whose lives and experience has brought tears and a crisis of faith. Make yourself known to them too and set them free. Truly you have risen, O Lord. Let the gospel trumpets speak and the good news spread to the very ends of all your good earth. You have risen, O Lord. Let all creation greet the good tidings with shouts of joy, for its time of release has come. The long night is past. The Saviour lives and reigns in triumph, now and through all the ages. And this we pray in his most blessed name. And in his words we do further pray and say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A reading from the Gospel according to St. John in the 20th chapter and from the first verse. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the tomb and the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scriptures that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Amen. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The hymn, "Christ the Lord is Risen Today."
Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to you on this Easter Sunday, and especially a warm welcome to those who are joining us either through the live link or later on this day or later on in the week. We make you all very welcome indeed. Can I just commend to you the intimations that you have in the intimation sheet. Just a reminder that Bryce is still off ill, so I will continue to provide the pastoral cover for you, and you can contact me at any time through the phone or my email address. also to say to you that the Palm Sunday service, which was very successful in many ways, raised £800 for the Christian Aid Ukraine appeal. And I know that there have been other monies raised during the week at other services. The last one I heard, I think, was probably Wednesday night, when I think it was about £400 was raised. So, you know, there has been a wonderful response, and we thank you for that. As I say, I commend all of these to you. There is one last thing which is not on the intimation sheet, but it's something that you will all enjoy. You've heard that there's a group of young people, I don't know what they're called, A zone, B zone, Z zone, oh, Y zone. Ah, there you are, all right. And you've been playing with Lego, yes? Right. Did you know that I was probably the first wee boy in Scotland to get Lego? I know you don't believe that, or you don't think I'm that old, but I am that old. And I had a family in Germany who brought Lego donkeys years ago. I was still in primary school, and nobody else had Lego. Can I just say, I wasn't very good with Lego, but I understand that you are. And I think we can see.
This is Jesus.
One day, long ago, he rode on a donkey into the city of Jerusalem.
12 men went with him. They were his disciples.
People shouted and cheered. Others laid palm branches on the ground.
That night, Jesus had a special supper with his disciples. This would be known as the Last Supper. Jesus picked up some bread and said, "Thank you to God for the bread," and broke it up. Jesus gave a piece to each disciple and said, "This is my body, which I give for you." Next, he filled a cup with wine. He lifted the cup. "This is my blood, I give it for you and for all people," he said. Each disciple took a sip of the ruby red wine. During the meal, a disciple named Judas got up and quietly slipped through the door. It was later revealed that he had deceived Jesus. After supper, they went to a garden. Judas was missing. He had gone to tell the enemies of Jesus where to find him. A full moon shone as Jesus knelt on the cool grass to pray. Soon after, a group of soldiers and priests came. They were very afraid of Jesus. They tied his hands with a rope and led him away.
They took Jesus to the Roman governor. The priest told lies about Jesus. The governor did not want Jesus to be killed, but he agreed.
They put a crown of sharp thorns on his head and laughed at him. Then they made him carry a heavy wooden cross up a steep hill. They nailed Jesus to the cross and put it on top of the hill with two other crosses. 3 hours later, Jesus cried out and died.
Later, before the sunset, a friend called Joseph took Jesus away and put him in a rocky tomb and rolled a huge stone across the entrance.
Mary, a friend of Jesus, went to the tomb. It was early on a Sunday morning and the stone had been rolled away. Mary looked inside the tomb, but it was empty. Jesus was gone. Just then, she saw a man standing by the tomb. "Where is Jesus?" she asked, jumping from her feet. "Mary," he said. Then Mary saw he was Jesus. Mary told all the disciples that Jesus had risen. After this, Jesus ascended into heaven.
May we remember to give thanks for what Jesus did for us. He died on a cross to take our sins away. Hope you have enjoyed watching our Easter film as much as we have enjoyed making it.
And a lot of skill. Thank you very, very much indeed. And I hope everybody who watches this enjoys it as much as we have. Thank you.
A reading from the Old Testament, the Psalm 118 from the 19th verse. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter in through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal processions with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. O, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Amen. May God bless to us the reading of his word. To his name be glory and praise. The choir will render the anthem, Now the Green Blade Riseth.
found this little reading while searching on the internet for some new material. And I took a copy of it and then forgot to note who the author was. But I know that she's a lady, an American minister. And this little thing just seemed so appropriate for today. She says, "In the church I serve, we will greet one another this morning with the greeting, Christ is risen, and the response will be, He is risen indeed. We join centuries of Christians in marking this day as the day that changed everything. We celebrate the amazing truth that although Jesus was dead, He's now alive forevermore. Christ Jesus rose victorious over death. He is risen." It's interesting to notice how John, the gospel writer, anchors the event of the resurrection to a day, a time, and a witness. On a particular day in history, early in the morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene saw that the stone had been moved away from Jesus' tomb. John wants us to be clear. The resurrection of Jesus happened on earth's soil, in our time, for the benefit of us humans whom God created and loves. Because Jesus is risen, life for us is forever anchored in good news. Christ's resurrection gloriously demonstrates that God's sovereign love has the last word. As a powerful hymn puts it, "No power of hell, no human plan can ever pluck me from his hand." We now live in the joyful assurance that because Christ lives, we too will live for all eternity. Christ is risen, He is risen indeed. Mary says, "I have seen the Lord." Our thoughts for today are that nothing in the world will ever be the same. On that first Easter morning, as the fingers of dawn started to banish the darkness of the night, Mary Magdalene made her way to the tomb, following an ancient custom in Palestine, that of visiting the tomb of a loved one for 3 days after the burial. But when Mary arrived, what she discovered shook her to the core. The stone had been rolled away. She ran. No wonder she ran. Who, especially a young woman known to be an associate of an executed criminal, would linger at a tomb that was no longer sealed? What was in there? Who was in there? A decaying body? Some grave robbers? Mary, to our eyes, did the only sensible thing. She ran to get Simon Peter. And so we find ourselves looking on as a story unfolds of three people discovering that their world will never be the same, but not in the way that they were thinking. It's clear, despite all that has happened, that Peter, notwithstanding his denial of Jesus, is still the accepted leader of this now shattered and forlorn group of disciples. It is to Peter that Mary blurts out her story. And it is Peter, without wasting a moment of idle questioning and speculation, who sets off at the run. John goes after him and seemingly outstrips the older man, arriving at the entrance first. And there he stops and looks in, going no further. But Peter, impulsive and headstrong as always, goes right inside. And nothing in the world is ever going to be the same for him. It must have stopped him in his tracks. There were the linen mortuary cloths and the napkin which would have covered Jesus' head, not lying with the rest of the cloths, but lying separately by itself, folded. Perhaps Peter would remember when Jesus called Lazarus from the tomb. Lazarus appeared still in the grave cloths. But this is different. So the inference is that Jesus left the tomb in a different manner from that of Lazarus. But it seems also that Peter wasn't quite able to process what had taken place. Peter's not a deep thinker like John. Peter's a man of action. He has to be doing something. Remember, when Jesus calls Peter, first of all, Peter sets off without a backward glance. On the Mount of Transfiguration, it's Peter who babbles away about setting up three booths, we might call them shrines, to honor Elijah, Moses, and Jesus. When Jesus is arrested, it's Simon Peter who draws his sword and strikes the high priest's servant, severing his ear. As if it wasn't bad enough for Peter that Jesus had been arrested, tried, tortured, and executed. But he, Peter, had hit the lowest ebb when he denied being a follower of Jesus. Now the body was gone. And worse still, the shroud was lying there. And none of this made sense to Peter. For sure, nothing in the world would ever be the same. I have seen the Lord. Well, for Peter, no, he hadn't. In fact, there was no trace of the Lord. I have little doubt that Peter was confused, bewildered, and incapable of swinging into action, because what action was there to swing into? Nothing in the world will ever be the same. And so to John. First to arrive at the tomb, but a bit more cautious. He looks in and then he steps back to watch as Peter ducks his head and goes right inside. We have the benefit of hindsight. As we look back from almost 2,000 years on, and we know that John is a thinker. In fact, he's a very deep thinker. In my opinion, John's the greatest theologian ever. Not just the greatest of his era, but the greatest ever. And when John comes to write his gospel, it's completely different from the other three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. John doesn't bother with chronology. He's not interested in a day-to-day account. I remember way back in the very early 80s at a presbytery meeting in Paisley. I don't know if you were there, Arthur. You might have escaped to Hamilton by the time this incident took place. The president of the Presbyterial Council of the Women's Guild. Now, that title ought to ring alarm bells with you. Yep. Well, bless her. She stood up to deliver her report to the presbytery of what the local guilds had been doing and achieving over the previous year. Our year began on the 14th of September in St. Mark's Old Hall at 7:30 p.m. We sang the 23rd Psalm, and then Mrs. Thompson read from the Bible, Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 14, the temptation of Jesus. The speaker was Mrs. McKenzie, who introduced us to the wonder of prayer shawls. Mrs. Hunter proposed the vote of thanks, wearing her usual fancy hat, and the evening concluded with the usual tea and cakes, June Graham's donuts being a particular favorite. 50 minutes later, we were devastated when the moderator gently intervened to bring this fascinating narrative to a somewhat premature end. We then introduced a rule that limited the outside speakers to 10 minutes. By the time that John is writing his gospel, the infant church already has three narratives establishing the story of the historical Jesus, as well as letters and papers from missionaries and evangelists like Paul and James and Peter himself. And by now, John is an old man who has had decades to mull over and sift through everything that had taken place with Jesus and all the teaching and miracles and special moments. So John is the thinker. And when he plucks up courage to go inside the tomb, he too sees what Peter saw and what we sing about, the folded grave clothes where the body lay. This is John's light bulb moment. He sees the burial clothes and realizes that unlike Lazarus, who appeared still in the grave clothes. There is no body. Lazarus, like Jairus' daughter, would grow old and die. But Jesus is not going to be returning in his physical form. And it's at this point that John believes that Jesus is indeed the Messiah, God's Son. John now believes completely and irrevocably that Jesus is who he claims to be, and nothing in the world will ever be the same. The resurrection of Jesus has changed everything, certainly for John, who later goes on to write his gospel, the opening lines of which are the definitive theological statement of all time. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. I have seen the Lord. Well, no, again. John hasn't seen the Lord, but he suddenly understands. He is the first to understand and to believe. And belief in Jesus, faith, ensures that the world will never be the same. I've always been a little disappointed in Peter and John, and especially my namesake John. The name John means God is gracious, or graced by God. Well, neither John nor Peter were gracious or thoughtful or concerned about the other person there at the tomb, Mary, the very one who brought the news of the empty tomb and no sign of Jesus, was left behind. Actually, for Mary, the world was changed from the very first time she met Jesus. She is mentioned 12 times in the Gospels, more than some of the original disciples. We're told that Jesus had cast out 7 demons from Mary. And although we don't really know what it means, casting out devils, we know that in those ancient times, many illnesses and conditions were attributed to demons or devils. The reality is that Jesus healed Mary of Magdala, changing her life. For Mary, nothing in the world would ever be the same from that first encounter. And so Mary had devoted her life to Jesus. She could never repay him for what he had done for her. I suppose in modern parlance, we might say that she loved him to bits. She was completely devoted to him, to the extent of being the first to dare to venture out at the earliest possible moment to visit the grave, there to grieve. Alone, as she thought, Mary now displays immense courage. She stoops down and looks into the tomb. We might be amazed that when she saw the two angels, she didn't race off in terror. But in those days, heavenly messengers were not always viewed with trepidation. Mary is calm. And when they ask her why she's weeping, she gives them a straightforward, simple answer. Her Lord has been taken away, and she doesn't know where they have taken him. She turns. She sees a figure whom she assumes to be the gardener, and she answers his question with a question of her own. And then when Jesus says her name, her world changes yet again in a way that she could never, ever have thought of. Her tears prevented her from seeing it was Jesus, but there was something in the way he said her name that meant she instantly realized it was him. To Mary belongs the glory of being the first person to see the risen Christ. To Mary belongs the honor of obeying the first command of the risen Christ to go and tell the disciples and pass on his message. And to Mary belongs the privilege of being the first person to make the declaration that conveys the most wonderful news. I have seen the Lord. Easter, resurrection, seeing the Lord. As the song from Aspects of Love says, nothing in the world will ever be the same. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. Amen. The hymn 425, The Saviour Died But Rose Again. We shall sing this remaining seated while the offering is uplifted and brought forward for dedication. Let us pray. There can be no greater gift to us, Heavenly Father, than the resurrection of Jesus, and no way that we can adequately respond to that. Accept, therefore, we pray, our offering of time and skills and faith as well as money, which we bring to you in faith and love. Amen. As we come to our prayers of intercession, just a reminder to you that there will be people whom we know of. There will be a moment for us to have our own private prayers. And just to remember to keep in our prayers, certainly Bryce and Helen, and we've one or two folks in hospital. Bob Conker is in hospital. He's in St. Andrew's Hospice just now, and Chris Brown. And I know there's one or two folks who've recently come back from hospital. And we also have a very close and good friend who is approaching end of life. Doesn't belong to this congregation. So all of us will have people that we wish to think about and to place into God's loving care. So let us pray. Christ is risen, we proclaim, announcing to the world that Jesus has broken forever the power of death over us. And it is in this faith that we bring to you, Heavenly Father, our prayers for others. Your world, Lord God, is filled with tired and downhearted people, enduring oppression, being victimized because of their color or creed or nationality, suffering hunger, loneliness, illness, and despair. Show us how we can best respond to our fellow men and women who depend on us to act with justice, compassion, generosity, and love. Your world, Lord God, is being subjected to immense ecological pressure, with climate change and toxic emissions wreaking havoc, countless species of animals and plants on the verge of extinction, and the powerful forces of nature having sometimes disastrous effects to land, sea, and air. Show us how best we can reorder our daily lives to reduce the impact we are having. Your world, Lord God, is experiencing massive changes in how people respond to each other, with intolerance, vicious messages on social media, outright hatred towards those who hold a differing view, and utter contempt being shown towards people who have faith. Show us how best we can hold fast to our faith in Christ, despite the opprobrium we often experience. Your world, Lord God, is far from being the wonderful, beautiful place you created it to be. Show us how best we can play our part in effecting changes for the better. At this Easter time, Heavenly Father, we proclaim the good news that Christ is risen, asking that through the power of his Holy Spirit, we might be able to bring that good news to bear, not just in your world, but also on our doorstep. Bless those who need you to be alongside them, Lord. Those who are ill, those who are downhearted, those who are lonely, those who are edging towards the end of this life, and all those who in love are trying to cope with the pressures these circumstances bring. Bless all who strive to bring peace, all who work to feed the hungry, all who are skilled in healing, all who display courage in speaking out for justice and equality. In the quietness of this moment, we bring our own private prayers. These prayers we ask through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, to whom with you the Father and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, dominion and power, now and forever. Amen. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son, our closing hymn this Easter day. My friends in Christ, I place you into God's loving care. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you this Easter day and always.